Well, hello, welcome to BK Live. I'm Aaron Watkins.
I'm Brian Vines. Thanks for joining us. Wednesday again, Aaron.
It is hump day, and we are getting over that hump together. Yes, yes, yes. So the Pope is going to be in town tomorrow.
Where
are you?
Isn't the Pope?
Well,
exactly.
He was in D.C.
He was on my TV on every single channel. He couldn't be escaped.
Everyone's amazement, the People's Pope, he did not get out of a limousine. As you said, he jumped out of a Fiat. So what do you think that means?
Well, we've got some Camera 5 action of the whip. But he's in a Fiat, the base model, just under $20,000. He's a man of the people, so he's driving like the people. This is like one of your grocery getters if you like have one of those car share services. The Fiat 500L
just rolls right up, and Pope jumps out, and there you go. So
surrounded by Suburbans, mind you.
You have to love
he's
it.
He's in his little
now,
Fiat.
Our lovely police commissioner says that 6,000 angels will be hovering around the Pope as he makes his entrance into New York City. So 6,000 cops will be on duty tomorrow.
Oh, like the ones around James Blake.
Absolutely.
6,000 angels.
And they are closing off 10 miles of street. So
what's been the most surprising thing for you with this papal visit and all the things that we get to see that we don't usually see?
You know, I'm gonna be quite honest with you. I mean, you know, I was just really surprised at the outpouring of support.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, you know, obviously this is the first time that he's come to New York City, to America, but you know, the amount of people that they are, you know, had in D.C. and that they're expecting for tomorrow.
Yeah.
You know, one of the Secret Service guys said, you know, there weren't this many people for Obama's inauguration.
Really?
Yes. So I'm expecting a lot of people.
How many million Catholics? There's like 70 million Catholics or something?
They said they expect over 1.2 million people to come out and try to see the Pope.
So. Oh, yesterday he got off the plane, he came down. And what I'm always surprised is like his robes, they always fly up. That little bib that's at the top.
Well, he did take his hat off.
Yeah.
He took his hat off when he got off because it's very windy. But then, you know, he was greeted by the president, first lady, first family.
In the Vatican who's making these vestments and say, why don't you just put a little chain in it to keep it from flying up? He gets off a lot of planes. It's windy there. It's an old trick, right? It, like Chanel used to like sew in
lay
little
it
chains.
Down. Smart.
Just like, come on, some dignity
you
for the
You think
man,
of everything.
For the father.
But, you know, at the same time, if you are heading to work tomorrow, please leave extra, extra, extra early. Not everyone will be blessed with the opportunity to see the Pope. Some of us will just be going about our regular activities. But do, you know, leave in time.
Some of us are home today. Have a safe and really reflectful Yom Kippur to our Jewish visitor. Viewers who may be watching or are going to watch later. So it's a holy, holy time.
Yeah, time for atonement.
Yeah. All right. Well, back in July, Mayor de Blasio's administration confirmed it will investigate a complaint that could apply to dozens of Brooklyn yeshivas. It's alleging that these parochial schools are violating state laws by offering students a subpar education in English, math, and other secular subjects, even though this year New York yeshivas received about $51 million from the city and state, plus millions more in federal funding. But at this point, the Department of Education isn't saying how it's actually pursuing the case. The chairman of the City Council's Education Committee, Daniel Drum, wants to know what's really happening, and he joins us in a few minutes.
Not to be missed. Well, the products of two very different kinds of schools. Big City Public High Schools will be here to talk PSAL football and basketball with Michael Bellamy. Chris Legree, founder and coach of the Mo Better Jaguars, was a star quarterback at South Shore High. He'll be joined by Devil Ellis, who made it all the way from James Madison High to the NFL, and we'll take a closer look at how he's taken that experience and turned it into his next career training young athletes.
All right, doing God's work. Then we get to the wine and cheese portion of the program, where there will literally be wine and cheese.
Yes,
because this weekend's Atlantic Annick, the city's oldest and biggest street fair, and two of the many vendors who'll be out there on Sunday will join us in the studio. And this is going to be the first antic for both of those business owners, one of whom owns Pear Wine and Cheese, and he's bringing in a red and a white because, hey, that's what you need when you're tasting cheese.
Yeah, a little bit of this, a little bit of that. Well, wine and cheese, football and basketball, that's all still to come. But in just a moment, Brian will talk to Daniel Drum of the city council and get into the whole question of how well the city's yeshiva students are being prepared to live in the wider world.
The New York State Education Department guidelines require that private schools provide an education that's substantially equivalent to that of public schools. Now, there are real questions as to whether that's happening at many of the city's Hasidic yeshivas. According to complaints by teachers, parents, and even former students, boys up to the age of 13 receive only about 6 hours a week of instruction in English, math, and other secular subjects. And that's pretty much it. After age 13, secular education stops when boys begin devoting themselves full-time to Jewish religious texts. Now, girls get more secular schooling because they don't study the Talmud. Our first guest, who is the chair of the City Council's Education Committee, said recently that he plans to push city officials to conduct a deeper probe than what they have done so far or described. City Council member Daniel Drum may be from Queens, but he's here to discuss an issue that's of great importance to our borough. Welcome to BK Live, Council member.
It's great to be here. Thank you for having me.
Thank you. So there is a petition going around that some 53 families have signed, and you've really been the loudest read-only voice on this in the City Council. And the last time I checked, we were pretty much outpacing you guys on yeshivas there in Jackson Heights. Why are you the one who's out front on this?
Well, you know, I'm the chairperson of the Education Committee in the City Council. And beside that, I was a New York City public school teacher for 25 years before I got elected to the City Council, and a director of a daycare center for 6 years before that. So education has been really my passion and the reason why I got involved in politics in the first place. So when Naftali Moster came to my office and made these allegations about what was going on in the yeshivas, in some of the yeshivas, not all yeshivas, right, by the way, but mostly Hasidic yeshivas, mm-hmm, I had to take that very, very seriously. I have an obligation to report any abuses or any misconduct in any of the schools or anybody who is receiving public funding to the Special Commissioner for Education, and I did that. I wrote to Richard Condon and let him know of the allegations that were being made, and it kind of crisscrossed with the same time that Yafed, the organization that has brought these allegations to light, right, was also making a press announcement about this.
So the timing seems to be aligned, but has the action been substantial or acceptable in your eyes?
Well, I was surprised that the special commissioner himself did not take up this issue and referred it back to the Department of Education. But then again, you know, I have oversight over the Department of Education, so that does give me the ability to further and question the Department of Education in terms of what their investigation is going to look like and what it looked like after the fact when they come out with a report, hopefully at the end of their investigation. But so far, the Department of Education has said that they're going to look at lesson plans, mm-hmm, and talk to administrators. To me, that's enough, not enough. I believe that it really needs to be more rigorous and that they need to go to the schools, they need to investigate, they need to look at schedules, right, they need to talk with teachers, they need to talk with students, and they need to take these allegations very, very seriously. And interestingly enough, after this happened, now we're hearing that similar things are happening in East Ramapo in, right, upstate New York. So it may not only be limited to New York City or to Brooklyn.
Well, indeed, it may not even be limited to the states. There was a recent case of a young man in Canada who is suing the schools there for about $1.2 million, saying that he wasn't substantially educated to deal with life after school. Are you fearing that there might be the same sort of reprisals here in New York?
Well, you know, when Naftali came to me, he described to me his difficulty of getting out of that way of life.
Right.
Because he did not receive an adequate education. He was not really
secular
fluent
education.
In secular education. He was not fluent in English.
Right.
He did not know what an essay was.
Yeah.
He did not know how really to deal with the outside world, which is what he desired to do. Now, parents have every right to raise their children and the way in which they want to. But there is New York State law that says that they must receive an adequate education substantially equivalent to that which people would receive in a public school system.
Right.
And for him to come in and allege that and to see the difficulties that Naftali had to face in order to find work and not be on the public dole,
right.
you know, it was very, very difficult for him. So that's why I take this issue really very seriously.
So speaking of that, public face of this, we know WNYC has done some great work and digging into this subject, and they've spoken with people who signed that petition who said, I went to the yeshiva that my sons are at right now, and I know I wasn't adequately prepared for the world outside, but my children are there, and I'm afraid to even use my name for fear of reprisal. So how do you break down that barrier to educate the kids?
Well, that's why I felt the obligation to speak out on this issue. And I think I'm in a unique position to be able to do that as the chair of the Education Committee.
Mm-hmm.
So I kind of had to bring it out of the closet, so to speak.
Does it help that you're not from Brooklyn as well?
Well, it may, and I mean, I know that there are political implications for many other elected officials in the borough,
mm-hmm.
but we need to go beyond that, because this is really about protecting children and making sure that children get the adequate education that they are entitled to.
Right.
And so, to me, it goes well beyond that, and I call on others to join me. This is not an attack against that community.
No.
This is trying to find out how those children can be better served, how those children can get an education in science and social studies, and learn about the world around them so that they have choices when they become adults, so that they can get better jobs when they become adults as well. That's ultimately what this discussion is about. So I view this as a desire to want to help Jewish children in those yeshivas.
So where's the money going?
That's a good question. And
$51 million. If you gave me $51 million, I suspect that I would have to give a receipt to you for something.
And
so
that's,
where's the accountability?
Right, that exactly. And that's the question, and that's where the oversight issue does come in.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where I can hold the DOE accountable
mm-hmm.
to find out what are they doing with that money? How are they spending those dollars? You know, those are taxpayer dollars
right.
given to schools for textbooks and for other types of things that they receive in order to educate the students in a secular manner.
Right.
And we need to know what is it that they're using those dollars for.
Have you heard any pushback from voices within the community who say, you know, we need the money to educate our kids, and maybe they're not as educated in secular things, but this is what we need to do to maintain the standards for our community?
Well, actually, every Jewish leader that I've spoken to has told me to continue with this push to move forward to find out exactly what it is that's going on in some of these yeshivas.
How many of them are going to be standing behind you when you're at City
Hall? Well, I don't
know
about that. I mean, you know, and some of them did speak to me anonymously or mm-hmm. asked me not to mention who they are,
gotcha.
But I've spoken to many leaders in the Jewish community. Now, not from the Hasidic community,
mm-hmm.
per se,
right.
but other Jewish leaders.
Yeah.
And they've urged me to go forward on this.
So looking at this, you're a city council member. You happen to be, rightfully so, as the head of the Education Committee. But from the sort of bird's eye view, I have some numbers that the UJA Federation said that 45% of Hasidic households in New York are in poverty. And when we look even deeper, that households with six or more people living them, presumably the parents and at least four kids, are at 64% of them are in poverty. So this is an education problem that maybe can help cure a poverty problem.
Absolutely, it's an economic justice issue as well. And that's another reason why I want to move forward on this, because we need to offer people the way out of poverty. And the way out of poverty has traditionally been, especially in this country, in the United States of America, through education. And so if children are not receiving an adequate education, adequate secular education, then they're going to continue that cycle of poverty and never be able to get out of it. And that's what Natili Moster told me as well. It was extremely difficult for him to become viably independent in the economic sense.
So to the best of your knowledge, what's a day like in a yeshiva that might not be living up to those standards?
Right. So I've never visited a yeshiva or Hasidic yeshiva. I visited non-Hasidic yeshivas.
Right.
But from what Naftoli told me was that most of the day, about 9 o'clock in the morning until 3 in the afternoon, is spent on religious studies, studying the Talmud. And that in the afternoon, when kids are tired, by the way, and kind of wanting to go home,
hopped up on sugar and other things. Yeah.
That's when they do the secular education. But it's minimal, you know. If it's an hour and a half, maybe you get 45 minutes of reading and 45 minutes of math, and that really leaves no room for the other subjects. And from my understanding, that's what goes on. And you were correct in your introduction to also point out for the girls it may be a little bit different because they are expected to go out and get a job while their husband or while their husband, I guess,
devotes himself to religious study. So we've evoked Naftali's name. I should let you guys know that he will actually be here later in the month along with a lobbyist, a person who's working on behalf of Hasidic yeshivas here. So we'll get some more balance and a full story, but while we do have you here, I'm wondering about the impact that this has on the community with outsiders all of a sudden looking into the schooling. How prepared is the city to take action outside of the investigation?
Well, the city is required by law to ensure, by state law, to ensure that those children are receiving that adequate education, equivalent to a public school education. So they have that legal mandate to do that, and they cannot fall behind on that. And in my job as the chair of the Education Committee is to ensure that the Department of Education is doing just that. And that's why I've chosen to speak out on this. So I think, you know, what we have to do is just open it up and talk about it, discuss it, find ways that we can improve it, and then to move on. And Naftali has told me as well, he's not out to destroy any community or to harm any community. That's not what this is about. This is about helping those kids get a better secular education.
Would you go as far as to say that this is a form of child abuse?
Well, if in fact what has been alleged has been occurring, it's, I don't know if it rises to the level of abuse, but certainly neglect.
Okay, so as neglect, are you prepared to bring in police to bust up these undereducating yeshivas?
So the people that were copied on the letter that Yafed wrote and 53 people signed on to included allegations across 7 school districts. It's the responsibility of the superintendents in each of those school districts to ensure that these schools are providing that adequate education. So we are going to hold those superintendents, the chancellor, and the other members of the Department of Education accountable for that to make sure that that's actually happening.
So I know we're winding up, but just to give a sense of scale, there are about 84,000 students in Jewish yeshivas, some of them Hasidic as well. So that 84,000 number means that the total number of kids being educated right now under the system is larger than the entire school system of Boston.
Correct.
They've got the money, but they don't have adequate instruction by a lot of measures. So what happens when oversight comes in to meet $51 million, you think?
So, and I just want to be clear also that it's not every yeshiva that's doing this. It's mostly within the Hasidic community, and I think that's the area that we have to look at. So we need to work on this with a scalpel, not with an axe, so to speak, that we have to, you know, find out what's going on.
You can get really granular. They're small enough where you can go in and really do an audit.
I believe that the other yeshivas are using the money properly. I've heard good stories about many yeshivas, you know, providing more superior education, even than some of the schools in the Department of Education.
Yeah. So. And I don't think it's anyone's intention, certainly not ours, to vilify the system, whether it's the particular wide yeshivas or the Hasidic ones in particular. But looking at the way that things stand now, who do you need on your coalition of the willing to reform?
Well, I would like to see more Jewish leaders speak out about this issue.
Publicly
speak out on this issue and take a stand on this issue. Because I believe ultimately that what we're doing is helping Jewish students. And I think that we have that right and that obligation to do that.
So you are an educator. This has been your life's mission. What's your best hope at the end of all of this, whether it's controversial or not, for the community and for New York in a great sense?
Well, that we'll be able to provide those students with that education. You know, I went to Catholic school my whole life, and I think I got a fairly good secular education as well, with religious instruction also. Yeah. And so maybe something similar to what I experienced as a student in a Catholic school is what I'd like to see happen in these yeshivas as well.
So as we're going to close out, I'm just going to ask you right now, because I can see the comment section lighting up already, what haven't I asked now that you would like people to know about the position of the city council on this, your personal opinion, or what you would like to do moving forward to help educate those underserved kids?
I think people should keep an open mind in both sides of the issue. I think that people need to hear both sides of the issue, which is why I'm glad that you're going to do a follow-up story on this, and that you know, somewhere therein lies the truth, and that what we need to do is just make sure that those children are getting what they need and deserve and what is required by state law.
And you're going to get a look at the books?
Yep, yep.
All right. Well, make sure to come back and share the results with us. We appreciate your time, council member.
Thank you very much.
Look forward to hearing your report.
Great to be here.
Thank you. Well, back in the late 1990s, Deval Ellis was an all-city football standout at James Madison. And as you're about to see, he played college and pro ball, and today he's devoted to training young athletes to go as far as their talents will take them. Have a look.
For me, academics was always the first thing. When I got to Madison, I was playing basketball. People were just like, yo, you want to go to school for free, play football? I was like, man, I'm too small to play football. They started showing me guys my height and size that could play football. I said, fine, if it's gonna get me a scholarship. Coach Ishmael, Coach Wayne Yearwood, who was a Madison grad, All-American at Hofstra, he took me under his wing. Before I knew it, I was in college playing college football. I broke the PSAL record for receiving yardage. I averaged 30 yards a catch in high school. 26 catches, 831 yards, 15 touchdowns. Maryland came down, looked me in the eye and said, you're too small. Coach Ty Willingham saw my film, came down, said, you're too small. Stony Brook offered me a partial scholarship to play slot, and I was left with a partial from Stony Brook and a partial from Hofstra. Although I had an 86 average, 12-10 on the SAT math verbal, I was extremely fast. I was an all-city player, all-state, didn't matter. I was from Brooklyn, I was too small, they didn't give a damn. First year at Hofstra, I hated it. I went from being the man in the PSAL, I was a walk-on. So since I was a walk-on, everybody was giving me the business. Like, you're not a scholarship kid. So they're looking at all the kids they give money to. So it don't matter how many touchdowns you score in practice, it don't matter how many one-hand grabs you have, they're gonna get the Joe Schmo from Jersey, who's 6'2", 215 pounds. He can drop 1,000 balls, they're gonna keep giving him opportunities. With that being said, I hated it. All I did was bust my butt, I worked hard. They ended up offering me a scholarship before the beginning of my freshman year because I worked my tail off. I went to Hofstra in the spring, I was there every day going into the summer. I worked my tail off, they offered me a scholarship, but I'm gonna be perfectly honest, man. I didn't think I was going to play in the NFL, and I didn't even want to try. I watched the NFL draft, and I watched how many small, undersized guys got looked over. And I said, you know what? Why would I do that to myself? Let me focus my energy on something that I really want to do. My receiver coach, Jamie Elizondo, I never forget, he's on the phone with me. He said, Deval, if you quit football and don't give the NFL a shot, you're going to regret it for the rest of your life. And I was like, you know what? He may be right. He may be right. I sat there on draft day, watching everybody else's name get called except mine. That Tuesday, the Lions called and said, we want to bring you in for a free agent tryout. My agent said, you can go in as a free agent tryout. There's no contract, there's no guarantee. You got to sign a waiver that if you get hurt, that you won't sue, and that'll be it. He said, that's all I got for you. You want to take it, you can take it. I said, that's all I got, that's all I need. I went to rookie mini camp and I freaking balled out. I came back with a 3-year contract. And that's how I got my shot in the NFL. First year in the NFL, you want to talk about politics. I hated it. I went out there and bust my ass, man, every day. I didn't drop any passes, returned 2 punts in the preseason. I did everything I was supposed to do and I got cut. I got put on the practice squad. They ended up activating me. I actually played so well that I got activated in the 6th game of the season. I returned punts and kicks. I led them in punt return yardage and kick return yardage the last game of the season. And the sad thing is that your job is not guaranteed. So you wake up every day feeling like this could be my last day at work. I'm talking about you go out on Sunday and you catch 3 passes and you like, I made 2 tackles. You walk in on Monday, they're working out 10 more receivers that got released from other teams. That was every day for me in the NFL. I played 3.5 years in the NFL. 3.5 years in the NFL. I love everything the NFL offered me. You know, I still have a nest egg, a foundation to start my business. I was able to buy some property. The business acumen I was able to develop, dealing with contracts, dealing with people.
There you go, step up.
You know, starting companies. I learned a lot while playing in the NFL.
There we go. Come
I
on.
Met a lot of
come
great
on.
People.
Come on, fight
it
through
just
it.
Inspired me that when I was ready to start my life and towards television, it gave me that ammunition I needed to move forth and be successful. I like having a platform to discuss what I've been through in my life. I feel like you may not have a bunch of LeBron James walking around Brooklyn, but you can have a DeVal Ellis. You can have a hardworking guy who's average height, who, you know, who dedicates himself to the books, who can be successful playing athletics, maybe just college, maybe a little beyond college, but develop his own program, develop his business. I feel like there's tons of kids around Brooklyn who are doing that, and I feel like media is my way of delivering that message. One word, DeVal Ellis. Unfinished. Unfinished.
Great piece. Also, before we get to our conversation, I want to congratulate Earl Newman on his light heavyweight title win in Atlantic City at the Sands Hotel. He won by a technical knockout, so hopefully he's on his way to a light heavyweight title. Right now, you know, summer is over and fall is here. We're going to talk about about young athletes, how they fare in the fall, especially when it comes to recruiting. And also joining me is DeVal Ellis, who's also live and in person, was just on the set. What did you think about your piece?
I didn't get a chance to actually hear it, but I'm excited to see it, man. It was great from what I saw so far, but I'm trying to get focused on what we have going on today.
All right, and also Chris Legree, founder of the Mo Better Jaguars. Matter of fact, you're up on the 20th anniversary, right? Because
yes.
You got started because of what?
The Million Man March.
That's happening October 10th.
It's coming up.
All right, my brother, that's good. Right now, we want to talk about what's happening so far this football season. You know, it seems like Tottenville and several other schools, we have like a three-way tie right now in first place.
Well, I always think it's too early to anoint anyone. Mm-hmm. Injuries really haven't happened. Usually every season you get key injuries, and that always factors in later. But from early assessment, Tottenville is a very well-coached team, and they play inside-out line play.
Right.
Grand Street is an explosive team who shows inconsistencies at times because they do make penalties.
Because right now, in the we have like a four-way tie. We have Tottenville, Grand Street, Midwood, and South Shore. And speaking of South Shore, this weekend they are going to honor you, right? Because you played at South Shore about several years ago back in the...
You're going to date me, but it's okay.
But they're going to honor you. But you were a quarterback and you went to Maine, University of Maine.
No, I went to University of Pitt. My son went to Maine. But they're going to retire my number 18. Also, my brother Rick is coming in from California. He is my receiver. They're going to honor his number 40. We were both all-city players in 1973, and we're very proud and honored.
All right. Well, congratulations. You know, there's all other issues out there that's on the horizon, and ethics when it comes to recruiting young athletes, especially at the youth football level. And allegedly, a lot of these high school coaches are out there like bees looking for the next honey that can really be a part of their program.
Well, I've said it a ton of time, the biggest recruitment isn't of Pop Warner kids. The biggest recruitment is Pop Warner coaches. A lot of the people on these high school staffs are going out and recruiting Pop Warner coaches to be on their staff because that's their inside track to developing athletes from early ages of 9 years old. Now you got coaches that are, you know, mentoring these guys from 9 all the way to 13, and you can start chirping their ear from the time they're 9. You know, you're only going to this school, you're only going to this school. And a lot of these athletes, you know, they don't have male figures. 75% of the kids that I train come from single-parent homes that are, you know, single moms. And the only male figures they have in their life are these coaches, and those are the guys they listen to from early.
Well, at Mo Better, we have an expression that kids don't sign themselves into schools, and that points directly to the parents. A lot of the single moms that he just described are manipulated, really, and they just don't know better.
How are they manipulated?
They don't know better, and they're manipulated by dreamy.
I mean, does the coach, for example, from any particular high school, we won't name high schools, but does he say, hey, you know what, I could get your kid, because of my school, I could promise him that he'll receive a D1 scholarship. to
Well, I mean, a lot of it, you know, some of it is that. But my biggest issue, well, not issue, but it's for the fact that if you're a single mom and you have a son who's 9 to 13 and you want to get him around some testosterone, you know, quote-unquote toughen him up, you bring him to a sport like football to get toughened up and you entrust these guys that they have your son's best interest at heart. So realistically, the manipulation is not done to get the kid. They already have the kid. The mom has already turned the kid over. It's that point where they take those advantages and they place the kid at a school that they want to, you know, to help build the program. And the thing that bothers me the most is a lot of these guys jump from school to school.
Who jumps?
A lot of these assistant coaches. You know, they'll work for they'll be a coach at a little league program and a JV coach, quote unquote, for a high school program. One year they're at this program, next year you're at a different program.
Okay, I mean that's, you know, but does that coach have a right to move around? After, you know, I mean, because that's the American way, right? That's
what absolutely. Said, right? Nothing really binds them.
Right.
Absolutely.
But I think in that lies the fault of it all.
Right.
There's no real commitment.
Right.
First things first, we talk about kids. Mm-hmm. Their education is the most important thing in their life. And I think when you dilute that, we talk about athletic ability, but most of these kids won't play Division I college football like you did. Okay? Right. They won't. I want to send my kid to a school by when he finishes junior year, tell me he's going to be SAT ready.
Right.
Tell me things like that. But again, the parents who are not well versed on the process, they get misled.
Take my parents, for example. I didn't play football until I was a junior in high school. My parents knew nothing about the recruiting process, NCAA clearinghouse, being eligible. They had no clue. So it was really dependent upon my head coach and my position coach to get me ready. And one of the things that bothers me is that a lot of these coaches, especially in the PSAL, don't understand the clearinghouse, period. There may be a handful that understand how to get kids eligible. For example, my brother Brian went through this. He was taking a Math A and Math B. Math A and Math B in 2003 changed to Math 1 and Math 2. Math 1 and Math 2 was not registered under the NCAA clearinghouse. No one in his school did the research to find out if he was going to be eligible with those two classes.
So there's not an athletic counselor that can assist them?
And this is the thing. Okay. There's no accountability for anyone in the building to make sure that these kids are eligible to play. And like Coach said, majority of these kids are not going to play Division I college football. I tell my kids all the time, there's the 1%. And that the 1%, the bottom line is they can get to Division I at any school. Take a Eshaq Williams, 6'5", 240. A Curtis Samuel, 5'11", 185, ran a 4.3 and a 40. Taysir Mack. These kids could go to any school and make it to a Division I because they're the 1% athleticism that they're looking for.
Are we talking about, then, sports reform? Does the system need to be changed from within
absolutely.
And on the outside?
Without a
because
doubt.
Because is that the problem? This has been going on for years. I mean,
absolutely.
This has been going on since the 70s. I mean, since the 60s, right?
Listen,
it's an ongoing problem.
Bob just made a great point, okay. And it's one word, accountability. Okay. It's the bottom line. In every school, there should be a compliance person who deals with these changes.
Level,
exactly.
That's all they do.
Exactly. We were just talking outside in the green room. A kid today can play in the PSAL and stay eligible. Minimum eligible requirements for 4 years,
four years.
And won't graduate.
Be all city, be a dominant athlete, maybe even all state, but then not graduate at the end of the year. How could you be eligible to play a sport, but then not eligible to graduate? And a lot of the coaches, and I've heard coaches say this, well, I can't kick a kid off for bad grades because if he's not on my team, then he can be out in the gang somewhere doing something, and I get that.
Right.
But then now that you've taken on this job, there's a responsibility and there's a standard that has to be set, and there's no one holding these coaches accountable.
So are we talking also about a sports reform in the DOE, Department of Education, and the public school athletic league?
No, we're talking about from the top.
From the top.
The first thing is that, and we've talked about this, there's a gap. There's a gap. And the bottom line is they don't care about our kids. They don't, because they don't live in our communities. Who from the DOE that makes decisions on PSAL live in East New York, Brooklyn, live in Flatbush, live in Canarsie?
Is this a complexion problem? I mean, because you don't have to identify some, you know, you don't have to have the complexion to have the connection to also understand the issues. Right?
I think it's a socioeconomic problem because there are not only black athletes playing in the PSAL. Huh. I think it's a thing where we have a lot of athletes in the PSAL from disenfranchised neighborhoods. The people who are making decisions are no longer from disenfranchised neighborhoods. They don't understand the plight of these young men and women that go to school on a daily basis who are trying to fight for their way out. And if sports is their only way out, they take it seriously. And I think the people who are making decisions up there don't understand the magnitude of the things that they're doing to our kids to hold them back. I really don't think so. We're the only league in the Tri-State area don't play on TV. Long Island plays, Jersey plays, Connecticut plays on TV. We don't play on TV. Why?
I think I like what you just said. I think our real job is to make them realize it's really not their only way out, but it's a way out. In other words, there's doors that can open just getting a good education and meeting the right people. There's so many ways to be successful in our society, but I think we got to change the culture a little bit.
Do we also have to change the culture as far as just sticking to football and sports as a way out?
No, I think it's good. It's good extracurricular activity.
I agree.
But the lesson, see, it's coaching too. What are you teaching really?
Right.
You got to teach life lessons,
right,
like preparation and accountability. That's what he just said, accountability. That's good in all aspects of your life. So I really think we got to look at what's being taught, and the accountability factor is critical. It's really critical that we improve these guys as people.
I'll give you an example. Okay. How football changed my life. Growing up, I was always the oldest. It was always about me. I had to take care of my brother, take care of my sister. So it always became about me. I was a very me person. And I played basketball. I was a very good basketball player. When the game got tight, it was give me the ball, let me do what I do. In football, I learned very early.
Integral part.
There's no me
right.
in football.
It's
I played
team.
Receiver. The center has to get the ball to the quarterback.
Right.
The quarterback has to get the ball to me.
Mm-hmm.
Linemen have to block.
It's just
so
like
I learned team.
It's just like it here. You have your camera people. You have your
exactly.
directors. It's all a team
Sports
effort.
Teach that.
However, transfer seems to be a big issue also. And I know we have a big case coming up pretty soon on Friday. Hopefully we will come back and discuss that also sometime soon.
Well, I mean, with the transferring situation, I'm going to be very honest. Social media plays a huge part of the transferring process, and a lot of it has to do with accountability. For example, back in the day when I was in high school, there was no Instagram, Facebook, all the other things that were going on in other high schools. I had no clue what was going on. All I knew was my little Golden Knight Madison world. But now when you're a kid in 2015 and you're at a Madison, for example, and you go on Facebook and you see XYZ schools going to Rutgers, XYZ schools going to Ohio State, you know, they have this many kids that are being recruited by that college. It kind of makes you wonder, well, what are we doing here at my little school that I'm not at that level? And kids are interacting. You get instant access to people.
But certain schools in the PSAA are pretty successful, right? I mean, you have Grand Street. They're doing a heck of a job,
right?
You have also some schools in maybe Lincoln High School, perhaps, also, and also schools in Staten Island, perhaps.
Well, truth be told,
right.
Michael, if you look at all the winning teams, they get transfers every year.
Every year, all
now,
of them.
Now, what kind of transfers, that's another story. Every case is different. The system itself, if you look at the bylaws of the deal, it's set up such that you do have flexibility and you do have movement every year. We're kids for various reasons. I don't want to get into the technical part. Listen, my family, we got a 50-year association with the PSL, for example. We have five or six all-city players in my family. But nobody never transferred, okay? But
you know
just
what?
Recently we had one, and it's because of
And in America, you have a right to
a lot
move.
Of times.
And you have the right.
Yes.
You know, but you're in the right to freedom. But unfortunately, in this country, freedom costs. And the thing is, are you willing to pay the price? Because unfortunately, you know, people pay the price for us to be where we are today, right? And I got to end on that note, gentlemen.
Well, listen, you can't have us here for 7 minutes. You need a longer show.
You need an hour show.
You need an hour show
you know what?
To talk about this. This
you
doesn't do it justice.
You got to talk to the powers that be.
Okay,
all
well,
right, up next, one of the key people behind this weekend's much-anticipated Atlantic Antic Festival, along with two of the participants, a retailer and a restaurateur. First, just to get you in the mood, here's what the festival looked like last year during its 40th anniversary.
To the 40th anniversary Atlantic Antic Festival. My name is Aaron Watkins, your MC during this official welcoming ceremony. Today, celebrating its 40th anniversary, the Atlantic Antic is more vibrant and exciting than ever. It has become a celebration of all that is good and positive in the borough, and that spirit of community and commerce that has made Brooklyn the place to be in the 21st century. Thank you to the Atlantic Avenue Local Development Corporation for once again producing this annual, yes, annual biggest and best street festival in New York City. When I say Atlantic, I want you to say Antic. Atlantic! Atlantic!
Rain or shine, it's Atlantic Antic time again, this Sunday, September 27th, so get out your walking shoes. Last week, we learned about the new Atlantic Avenue Youth Scholarship Program, which only makes a great event even better. Today, we meet the head honcho behind all the hoopla and two new Atlantic Avenue merchants who've decided to join in on the fun.
That's right. First, we want to welcome back to BK Live, Board President of the Atlantic Avenue Local Development Corporation, Mr. Christian Haig. Welcome back.
Thank you.
And we also want to welcome Michael Dizenbach. He's the owner of Antler and Woods, a variety retail store that sells items ranging from hats and designer hoodies to silk pocket squares. And I suspect that jacket you're wearing over there.
It is.
All right. And we also want to welcome the man behind Pair, that's P-A-I-R, as in pairing wine and cheese, which looks really beautiful in their photos. Chung Park is here, and he's brought a sample or two of his wine list and a few cheese selections. Thanks for joining us.
All right, it's Atlantic Antic time
again. Yeah, it is. Right.
No
is rain. You said rain or shine.
Rain or shine.
There'll
it's
no
not
rain.
Gonna be
rained.
It's no. already in the forecast. Christian, you've been with Atlantic Antic for a while now, Atlantic Avenue, A-A-L-D-C. 41st year, can you tell us what people should expect?
Yeah, I mean, last year we thought we outdid ourselves on our 40th anniversary. This year we're just blowing that out of the park. I mean, we have 15 stages this year. We have a community stage. We have Broadway performers coming out. We have more merchants, more vendors. It's really amazing how far we have come, how far we continue to go, and that we keep improving and getting bigger year by year.
Okay. Now, I had the distinct pleasure of hosting one of the stages last year, the official stage.
We saw you up there.
Oh, yeah, we did see that. You were looking GQ yet again, always looking wonderful. How many people were in attendance last year? What was the official tally?
So, I mean, I didn't count, but they report about 1 million people. Hopefully, we have 1.2 million if you guys came out this year. Yeah. Million people.
1.2 million, and then 1.4 million because you
guys definitely be there.
Are new to the scene. So how do you feel about joining this proud Brooklyn tradition?
I mean, I'm excited about it. I actually live on Atlantic Avenue, so I know this as, like, the neighborhood event. So it'll be very interesting to see it, like, as the vendor and, like, you know, different relationships. You know, this is a chance for us to get to know our neighbors and to build relationships with maybe people who always don't frequent Atlantic Avenue.
Well,
so I'm super excited.
Better than facilitating new meetings than a little drink of wine and cheese.
Totally. Yeah, well, we're going to be there. I mean, you know, we're really excited just to see all the people and just have like a bunch of people just lining up for some wine and cheese and other great foods. We just want to get that exposure.
Okay. Now, you opened in January, had a soft opening in January.
Yes.
You've been open since February. You know, why did you decide to take part in Atlantic Avenue? And what, you know, are you sort of expecting from the Antic this year?
It's hard to say. I just know that there's just going to be a lot of people. And we're expecting, you know, just the exposure of people to that first of all, that might not know that we're there, to finally know that we're there, and then, but also just spread this whole idea of, you know, pairing your wine and cheese and having great food and just having a nice place to hang out. Yeah, to just as many people as we can get that word out to.
Well, we can see some of your wares here, but I'm wondering if you could give us a little description about your home on Atlantic Avenue.
Yeah, so,
not your home, your store home.
Yeah, of course. So Antler and Woods is basically the baby of where country roads and street culture collide.
Okay.
So that's what we like to say. We produce like limited quantities, so, you know, ranges from 100 to 200 pieces, and once they're gone, they're gone. So it's very limited right now, and you know we're releasing some funky things for the Antic and all of that. This jacket being one of them, so you'll be able to pick that up on Sunday. But yeah, I mean, it's been a ride I think for us just to see the transition of Atlantic Avenue, and which is why we wanted to open our business there.
You know, now you're also a designer,
right?
Can you tell us some of the fundamentals of your collection?
Yeah, so we design. You know, I have a business partner. We design everything. Seasonally, obviously. So, you know, for example, we have like this apple jacket for fall and things like that. So, you know, everything's geared towards, you know, our fall line will be heavy Brooklyn related, which mm-hmm. is, you know, Brooklyn.
Gotta touch it.
Yeah, satin.
you know, the fact.
The Brooklyn brand is hot right now.
Yeah.
So, you know, I have a few other things that I can show you guys. So we'll be selling Brooklyn pennants, felt pennants. Yeah, we make these all of ourselves. Cool. And then this is our bestseller, the Frontier 5 panel with the suede brim.
Who's that?
Yeah, pass it around.
Oh, it's suede. You can see
Okay, suede. Sure, I'll take this one.
I mean, that might be your look right there. And then our newest one, this is the Brooklyn wax canvas polo hat, and it's felt lettering like old style baseball hats. And it's waterproof, weatherproof.
So. Beautiful work. So,
yeah,
Christian, it's working. Clearly,
it's working.
You've gotten these two snared in the Atlantic Avenue merchants. Right. But what is something, this is basically the public face in what people know of Atlantic Avenue. But behind the scenes, it's a lot of work to make this and just business happen every day.
Yeah, I mean, someone was asking me, when did you guys start planning this? I say we start planning it the Monday after the Antic. We have a great team. Again, this team has gone above and beyond our expectations this year, brought more sponsors than we've ever had before. And again, we get all these great vendors who want to be part of it.
Right.
And that's sort of the beauty of the Antic. It really gets people to come out who've maybe never been to the Antic before or who are revisiting, seeing new shops, get a little taste, check out some wares, and then come back. And that's really our goal at the ALDC, is to get people to come out that day, but really come out again, revisit Brooklyn, check out Atlantic Avenue, and shop Atlantic.
You know, I'm not a very big shopper, I have to admit that, but
despite outward appearances, this is not
Atlantic Avenue, Atlantic Annick was such a great opportunity last year for me to get out some of my, you know, holiday shopping.
Shopping.
I did my holiday shopping. Good. Well, I did the holiday shopping for like some of the females in my life. Like I have nieces. I have a lot of nieces and like cousins and things like that. So Atlantic Annick was the perfect opportunity for me to go out and see all of these Brooklyn vendors and people that one might not necessarily meet or have the opportunity to see. But they were all in one place. I spent the entire day just walking around with my bag. And like, you know, I got some really, really choice gifts, and I was the cool uncle.
Well, now Michael is there for the fellas. You can do the other half of the family.
Yeah, right. I mean, just trying to bring a little flavor to the block, you know?
Well, there they're going back to Baltimore. They could use a little more flavor.
Well, everybody, hey, Brooklyn, that's all I have to say. Everybody loves anything that says Brooklyn.
Right.
Am I right? So
that's
why
right.
is that right now?
Yeah, I mean, I was...
And when is it going to stop?
I was in San Francisco last week, and every shop, they had something Brooklyn-based. And I went up to one of the vendors and said, why do you have all this Brooklyn merchandise? He said, Brooklyn is the epicenter of cool. Mm-hmm. And it took 41 years to get there, but we're still cool. We're getting cooler. And again, come check out the cool products that we have on that day.
Well, okay. I think that's worth
the toast. That's a toast.
We can toast to that.
Yeah, can
come
we,
on, Chuck.
Yeah, why don't we try
might
some,
have to
toast.
We might have
I think back there might be some knives that I brought along
with
me.
We'll get to the cheese.
Okay.
Come on.
Yeah,
we're
focused on the wine right now.
All right. Well,
I don't know if we got a chance to see these shoes that you have on here. I don't know if the cameraman can get my friend Michael's shoes right here. But these are absolutely fantastic. They just go with your whole decor and wardrobe. I mean, so do you style as well? If somebody comes in, do you say, hey, look, we're just going to help you out and...
Yeah, I mean, I like to give input, right? And you don't want to be pushy when you're in the store, but you can tell when people are like very curious and they want an opinion. So you obviously, like, you know, I always, yeah, that looks really good, or you know, you could wear this with this, or so. I mean, you have to help, but not be pushy. Okay. You want people to feel relaxed in the store.
Okay.
You know, the store is a place where, like, when we opened it, I wanted it to be like a community space. So we like have events in there. We have a big couch and like a lounge chair. So like. You know, the premise is, yeah, you want to shop, but come hang out, you know. You know, you can have a drink in the store. We have, like, Mexican Cokes and all of that in store. So, like, just come hang out.
It's such a big, large event. What's the best way to sort of tackle seeing everything? Is it possible? Can you do it in a day?
Yes, you can. I mean, I've done it in a day. The really unique thing this year is on our website, atlanticav.org, you have a whole map of what is going to be what vendors are on the avenue, what booths are on the avenue. So you can go there beforehand, check it out. You can go in the Daily News. They're going to have a whole layout.
Whole day.
What's that?
You can chart your whole day.
You can chart your whole day. I mean, you can even figure out what subway stop you want to get off at to go right to your particular vendor you want to check out that day.
That's smart. I'm going to ride my bike.
There's an app. Yeah, there's a Topi app. Cool. That we're doing this year. First time that we're having an app. We're getting into the 21st century. So check out our app, hashtag Atlantic Ave on your Instagram. Again, go to our website, Atlantic Avenue, atlanticav.org, and you can get a whole spreadsheet of where to hit that day.
All right, Chuck, what are we drinking?
Well, we have some Prosecco from Veneto, where Prosecco kind of originated. It's made by Calabrigo. It's a family-run winery out in Veneto, Italy, and it's particularly good. I'm gonna have to ask if you don't mind getting your fingers a little bit sticky.
Oh, no, not at all.
All right, so this is called Delisa Bergogna. It's what you call a triple creme cheese. It's cream and rich. So when you have it with the bubbles from the wine, it just kind of dissolves the cheeses. And that's what we kind of do at Pear. We kind of give you a little direction of how the cheeses work with the wines. So
it's so smooth. This cheese is so delicious.
It's like super buttery. And then try it again with dissolving it with the wine.
All right.
It's the Aaron Watkins of cheese. It's so smooth. Mm. What do you think?
Silence.
Wow. I'm waiting.
No. You know what? Because it's just dissolving in my mouth right now. It's such a great pairing. So, you know, what is it that people really need to know when they're trying to pair things together? What's the fundamentals?
A lot of times you want to match strength, you know, stronger cheeses, stronger wines, milder cheeses with lighter wines. But, you know, there's a lot of kind of science involved, but, you know, we just make it easier for you. You just come out, chill, hang out, you know, and we'll give you the advice, you know. And you know, it's with the wines, with the foods as well. You know, we have great dishes such as, like, you know, charred shishito peppers. You know, this great salad with cultured cream and beets and smoked salmon. It's just like.
Sold.
Yeah.
Well, Christian, I know these are all like first among equals, but what are you most excited to check out this weekend at the Antic?
Oh, I mean, I would be shutting a lot of people out if I picked one thing. You know, to be honest, I'm just excited to see everybody, excited to see old faces, new faces, meet people that have never been to the Antic before, trying to get my family from Long Island. That's what I'm really excited
good luck
about.
With that.
Experiencing it through their eyes.
Exactly.
Good deal.
Exactly.
I'm sure the LIR is going to be crowded.
What do we have here?
I can't go without giving my merchandise. So we're selling this at the Antic this year. We have a limited edition green one, and then we have our standard Antic t-shirt. It's 41st. We're sort of spicing it up, getting a little funky with color. Okay. And we have tank tops too we're selling.
And tank tops. Gotta love tank tops. Well, you know,
we'll have to test.
I live in Brooklyn, so I'll probably cut it up some of my muscles off or something too. You know what I mean?
All right, bring him out on Sunday.
You know?
All right.
Awesome.
Nice.
Oh, well, you know what, Brian?
At the end,
we have a place to have our wine and cheese. We're definitely going to have to get, you know.
Check out.
Yeah, Michael's so
done up.
If you want to empty those glasses, I have some red Pinot Noir for you.
All
guys,
right,
too.
And then we'll
cheers.
Take it away.
Cheers to
cheers.
The
to the
thank
Antic.
You for having
41st.
Us.
And no water. All right, so Michael Dizenbach from Antler and Woods, Chuck Park from Pear Wine and Cheese, and of course, Mr. Haig. And tell us about what times again. When should we be coming out?
Start at 12, we go to 6. Come check out all the stages. There's a community stage. We're going to have performance by Wicked. We're going to have great, like, Brooklyn performers are going to be there. We're going to have some politicians coming to check out and come speak at the Antic this year. So really, between those windows, come on out, get great food, check out great merchandise, have some great beer, yeah. Some great local foods, and just enjoy the day.
Sunday,
and stop
Sunday,
and say
Sunday.
Hi. Yeah. Sunday, Sunday, Sunday.
All right, and support Brooklyn.
That's right.
All right, thank you so much. Congratulations.
Yeah, thank you guys. We really appreciate you having us and helping us promote it. We totally appreciate it.
Let's see it again next year.
Sounds good.
Cheers.
Thank you.
Cheers again.
Cheers again. It's that good.
Well, tomorrow on BK Live, we'll talk to some Brooklyn Catholics about what the papal visit means to the city and the borough.
That's right, and Stuart Little loved to sail on model wooden boats, but at a recent Red Hook regatta, the contestants were definitely not mice, and they made all of their own boats using 3D printers. We'll show you which geek won the race.
Pretty impressive. We'll also learn about an online oral history and public photography project going on in Bedford-Stuyvesant. It's called Griots and the Sty, a neighborhood as a living archive.
And for the very first time in weeks, or should I say weekends, Dick and Dave will be here to tell us what's going on in Brooklyn this Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, other than the Atlantic Antic, of course. Providing a cocktail will be the owner of the aptly named Drink in Crown Heights.
All right. Well, it's been a fantastic show, and thank you so much for watching. We'll see you at Atlanta and it.
Bye now.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Not bad for a Wednesday.
Yeah, right?